Welcome, lords, ladies, and other Audi drivers, to this week's episode of Talk of the Devil. I am your host for this week, Joe Dodd, and as you can tell from that fantastic musical intro, the Doctor Who theme, this is a very special themed episode today. This is a history-themed episode. Myself and my esteemed panel of the hottest young comedians Lancaster has to offer. You can take my word for that because this is an audio medium, so you can't actually tell. I promise. This is a history-themed episode, like I say, so we're going to be working through news stories, true and false, from the past. So with that, our panel, we have the stupendous Kamran Khan. Hello, nice to see you, Kamran. We have the excellent Baqir Datoo.
Hello, more like Dr. Wen, am I right?
Dr. Wen. That needs to be a series of those. Get him off! And finally, we have the inimitable John Lee.
Hello, hello. Just try and imitate me, you bastards.
I realized I used that adjective for you last time, but I didn't prepare anything, so I just grabbed for the first word I could think of. Yeah. How you guys all doing?
Good. Good.
Yeah, doing good.
Good.
Yeah, glad good. To hear it.
Yeah.
I hope you're all bringing your A game. So, we are going to head into the game without further ado. So, our first round for this game is called Mind the Gap. I will read you a series of news stories. These are all absolutely true, but the headlines have had words removed from them, and you have to fill in the blanks. And as I say, these are all history questions. And I can tell you that this first round, the questions are all from the 19th century. So 1800 up till 1899. Anything in that is fair game. You guys ready?
Okay.
Yeah.
So nothing about Kim Kardashian.
Okay. Oh, no, nothing. Nothing. Yeah. Although I have heard it rumored she's a time traveler, so she might crop up in here somewhere. Just keep an ear out for it. Okay, so we can also definitely state that none of these were written by Rupert Murdoch, although actually perhaps not.
Oh, so they'll be true then?
Yes. we take on the big subjects here.
Taking down big newspaper, what it's called.
Yeah, absolutely. We take no prisoners. Okay, so first story. How to blank getting in a blank. How to blank getting in a blank.
I feel like the first word is avoid.
What was that? What was that, Baqir?
How to win getting... I was going to say, is it how to win getting in a blank?
I'm afraid it isn't, but that would be a very useful article. However, I can say that John already has won the first point.
Yes.
What?
Avoid. The first word is avoid. So it's how to avoid getting in a blank.
How to avoid getting in the car?
That, I feel like there's some dark backstory there, Cameron.
Well, I feel like obviously when there's something new comes along, the people press really like try want people to avoid it. It's like the cars come out. It's like you want to avoid getting in the car and stick to good old fashioned giant bikes with one massive wheel at the front.
I hope there is an article with more interesting. Yeah, I hope there is an article with that exact wording somewhere. However, the second blank is not car, I'm afraid.
Okay. How to avoid.
How to avoid getting...
Is it accident? Is it accident? Like, how to avoid getting in an accident?
You're not far off. Again, it's kind of a semantic thing. It's in the ballpark of accident, but the word is not accident.
Pickle.
Is it how to avoid getting in
a... John, you win.
Oh my God.
John gets both questions right. Yes, the headline is how to avoid getting in a pickle.
Oh, wow. In all fairness, John does have the essence of an 18th century window sweep. So
window sweep? What the hell is a window sweep?
Yes, it's
like a chimney sweep, but for the windows that got soot on them.
It's when they get too big for the chimney, they move on to the window.
Yeah, and you literally sweep the window with the kid. Just grab the front of his waistcoat.
Now I've got a theme for this, the old-timey language.
Yeah, go on, CD yourself. Oh, my.
Apples and pears, Governor. Where?
Apples and pears, where? Why is Wario here?
Because he said apples and pears.
Does he now?
Well, I can't... He doesn't say pickles, so...
Yeah. Well, I can tell you that John has won both those points. The headline is How to Avoid Getting in a Pickle, and this is how the story goes. This story is from the Worcester Chronicle from the 30th of November, 1859.
All right.
It goes like this. There is at present in the Bradford Infirmary a basket maker named Charles Sutton, who has been suffering from symptoms referable to poisoning by lead. He has lost the use of his hands, but is improving under treatment. After much fruitless inquiry as to the cause, it was found that the man had been wont to eat pork which had been pickled in a lead cistern. Oh. It is said to be the practice of pork butchers at Bradford, and perhaps elsewhere, to pickle pork in such cisterns under the idea that the process is thereby facilitated. The plan, however, is fraught with danger to life, as the lead is certain to be corroded by the salt. So yes, this is the story.
I see.
A guy in Bradford was lead poisoned by eating pork that had been pickled in a lead pot. For anyone who's ever watched Horrible Histories, which I hope is most of our listeners, you learn that lead is basically the root cause of most poisoning in history. You know, it was in makeup, it was in drinking water, it was in bath water, and apparently it was in the meat they were eating.
When people weren't dying of other diseases, it was lead.
Yes, exactly. Like in the kind of pantheon of causes of death, lead was always just kind of waiting there for someone else to step out of the office. Okay, is anyone else up next? I'm happy to take the hours, and then he goes in, and people die of lead poisoning.
Lead was the Poseidon.
You have the bubonic plague from, you know, 5 till 4.
Yes, bubonic plague from 5 till 4, lead poisoning 5 till 6, and then cholera's in for the night shift. What were you saying just then, Baqir? Sorry?
No, I was going to say, if we're describing diseases as a pantheon, you know, I feel like lead would kind of be the Poseidon of the group. He's not like, in charge, but, like, takes care of the stuff you don't really, like... Like it's kind of off to the side. It's always there, though, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
Like, you always know someone who died from lead poisoning.
Yeah, just like how you always know someone who died from Poseidon, who's a horrible bloke.
Oh, yeah, that's why my favourite Roman emperor tried to attack the sea, you know?
Yeah.
After doing the incredibly smart thing of making his horse an advisor.
Yeah.
Sometimes, you know, when you're surrounded by an yes man, you need someone to tell you nay.
I have not heard that before. That's very good.
That's mine. Don't worry.
Okay, so that was our first story, guys. So, yeah, poor bloke got poisoned with pork. However, I didn't find out what happened to him. Probably he died, like, as soon as lead was done, he died of cholera.
he just stepped out of the doctor's, then slipped on a banana peel, and then got hit by a bus, and
that's a rough day, isn't it?
Speaking of history, that's one of my favorite stories. This guy survived going over Niagara Falls in a barrel, right? Like, fully survived this huge insane drop. And then later he died by slipping on an orange peel.
Bobby Leach, he was a stuntman. He also swam the rapids at the bottom of the falls. You're exactly right. And he died slipping on a fruit peel. Hilarious. stupid death. I feel like I'm stealing an awful lot from that show.
It's a great show.
It is the thing about plagiarism. If you don't tell people, it's history, so it doesn't technically count.
That is an excellent point.
The key here being, don't tell people you're repeatedly stealing from Horrible Histories.
Yep, and John can edit this out, because this isn't really live.
That's very true.
The power of Talk of the Devil no longer being on live radio.
Shit, fuck, okay. Cock, crap, cock. Yes. Feels so
watch
good.
John, watch your fucking mouth.
Oi!
Our freedom!
Ah, shit.
I'll never forget, I swore on an episode of Talk of the Devil once, when we were recording in studio, and it's one of those memories I have where I, like, cringe inside every single time I think about it. Luckily, it wasn't a live send-out. It was being recorded to be put out later, so it could be edited. But I will never forget the look on the host's face when I did it. Oh, dear.
I remember once I was doing, I think it was Talk of the Devil with John and Thazar. And Thazar asked me a question and I panicked and I said, the queen is dead. And he had to cut the recording.
Oh, God, no.
I know, it's so bad. Like, he fully just stopped it. I can't remember what he asked. I was just like, no, the tweet is dead. And he's like, no, we can't do that.
Oh, no, that's terrible.
Yeah, I felt so bad.
What I can say right now is that this round does not contain any answers for which the queen is dead.
Does it contain any for which the queen is alive?
In fairness, no. But anyway, we'll move on to our next question. Well done, John. That's 2 points for you. So our next historical story.
I was just saying sick.
All right. You need to get stronger swear words. Anyway, man blank for selling blank without a license. Man blank for selling blank without a license.
Sorry, man arrested.
Cameron, what was that?
It was jailed.
Jailed. I'm afraid Baqir gets that. It was arrested.
Damn it. Okay.
Very close, Cameron. But if Baqir hadn't jumped on that, I would have probably given you the point. But yes, man arrested for selling blank without a license. There is still one more blank to be unblanked.
Children.
No. That is actually
I miss when you could sell kids.
God, I've got all these kids on the backlog. I can't sell them.
Dude.
Can't live with them.
Is it horses?
Horses, no.
Meat?
Cows.
It's not cows, it's not meat. With meat, you're getting a little bit closer.
Vegetables.
Okay, it is a vegetable. It's a
apple and pears, aubergines, tomatoes.
No. You've, by the way, Cameron, you mentioned a bunch of fruits there. So, sorry, couldn't help. I couldn't help putting that out.
And pineapple, no,
carrots.
That's a fruit.
Did you say it was a vegetable?
It is a vegetable.
Potatoes.
Yes. Nope.
Carrots.
Tomatoes.
No.
Tomatoes.
Tomatoes is a fruit. No.
You caught me on a technicality.
Oh, I'm always on the lookout for technicalities. Me, I was a creative writing student. Still am.
Peas.
Peas, no.
What vegetables?
So I'm trying to think what vegetables were then just like you're not allowed to sell without a license in the 1800s.
Broccoli.
Broccoli, no. Did you have another guess before that, Cameron? Sorry.
I said carrot, but I think you might have said no.
No, it's not carrots.
Yes. Well, what vegetables might you have needed a license for? Chili peppers?
I can't really think of any because they're not exactly dangerous.
Exactly.
No. Mm. Have you got a license to carry that?
Onions.
Celeriac. No, not onions.
Celery?
Celery, no.
Spinach?
Spinach, no.
Cauliflower?
It's not a leafy one, if that helps.
Cucumber?
No. Good guess, but no.
Mm. Oh my gosh. Oh. Okay, I'm in the vegetable aisle of Sainsbury's.
Parsnip.
That's cheating. Surely you can't be looking at vegetables. You have to know what they are.
I'm mentally.
I think he's in his mind palace. Don't worry.
Yeah, his mind palace is Sainsbury's.
Is it just like peppers?
No, it is not peppers. I'm afraid. Yeah.
Chili's a vegetable?
Nope.
Asparagus.
No.
I'm asparagus.
No, I'm asparagus. Sorry, it took me a second to get that.
Oh, wait. Is it corn?
It is not corn, no. Okay, try and think a little bit bigger than that.
Butternut squash.
Watermelon. No, that's a fruit.
Butternut squash, no. And watermelon, yeah, that's a fruit.
Aubergine?
Aubergine, no.
Pumpkin?
Pumpkin, no. But close-ish with pumpkin.
Not watermelon.
Is it a type of gourd?
Pineapple.
No, that's a fruit.
A marrow. Ah.
Marrow, no. Okay, if I tell you that it's a vegetable that no one really eats anymore, like it's just not really a thing.
What's an old-timey vegetable?
Not sprouts.
Not sprouts, no, because unfortunately people still eat them.
Unfortunately.
Yeah.
Do you still see it in shops or not?
You do, yes. But like, I can't ever remember being served it, except on a very specific night of the year. So it's sometimes eaten as a part of a special day.
Oh. I can imagine that would be Christmas then.
Yeah.
It is not Christmas, no. If I tell you it's Burns Night.
Oh, so is it a haggis? Well,
Haggis isn't a vegetable, I'm afraid, John.
I'm sorry. Okay, what do these mental Scottish people eat?
As we all know, haggis is... Parsnip? No, I'm afraid not. Anyone else?
Can I just have a point?
Afraid not, because unless we get a lot...
it's worth a try, right?
Yeah, unless we get a lot closer or we get a lot further away, then... afraid I can't give you the point.
Neeps, that's a Scottish
yes!
word.
Yes! Yes, wait, you're exactly right. Do you know what a neep is? What's the
actual word? It's just a Scottish thing, it's a dish.
Neep is, when you talk about Burns Night, neeps are turnips, and that is what it is, it's turnips. I'll be honest... We weren't going to get any closer, so I'm going to give that to Kamran. So, yes, Kamran, you win the point. Man arrested for selling turnips without a license.
And you said Burns Night. I was like, okay, Scottish. What's the Scottish for? Haggis and neeps? What is neep? Is neep a vegetable?
It's a right line of logic. Yes, so let's read the story of this frivolous and dangerous felon. This is from the Quebec Saturday Budget from 1877, and the story goes like this. On Saturday last, a young farmer from Quebec named Robert Wright arrived in town with several friends, bringing with him a large quantity of turnips for sale in the city. Totally ignorant of the bylaws, he sold 2 barrels of turnips on the street this morning without having a license to do so. One of his supposed friends, named Caldwell, immediately informed a policeman of the occurrence and pointed right out to him at a distance. So this guy shows up in town with 2 barrels of turnips, sells them, and then gets dobbed in by his friend.
Can I just say, Caldwell a snitch?
Yes, yes. And we all know what snitches get.
Yes.
Snitches get nips.
They get neeps.
Neeps. Imagine if they paid him in turnips. Imagine if it was just a huge turnip feud.
I know. But, like, it's so... Like, that made the news, guys. Like, if anything, that just proves to you that Canada has its shit together, because that's the kind of crime that makes the news in Canada. Some guy...
In 1800s.
In the 1800s, when, if anything, worse things were happening all over the world. Some bloke was selling turnips.
Well, you say that, but...
Yeah.
Maybe it's a cultural thing. Maybe selling turnips was like the worst without a license was like the worst crime imaginable in Canada. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Someone's just sitting there eating the morning paper, he drops his turnip in his hand, hear it hit the floor, and he's like, "You'll never believe this, Margaret. Oh my god."
It's like you know, like in the 20s in America when they were running bootleg liquor because of prohibition. In Canada they were doing it with turnips. Yeah, there was a Canadian fella who was exactly like Al Capone in every sense, but he got rich from selling illegal turnips rather than illegal booze.
I just supplied a demand.
Mounties.
Oh, that's a great line. That.
Well, the thing is, I hope he turnipped profit. No, I didn't.
Turnip to profit. I know. I'm sentimental to jokes of that kind, but that's very funny. But here's the other thing. Clearly, like John just quoted from Al Capone, he was supplying a demand. This bloke had 2 barrels of turnips and sold them in one morning.
Damn.
Like,
that's demand. Just more about. I feel like nowadays enough people don't go to town hoping to buy, you know, fruit or vegetables in barrel quantities.
Exactly.
Have we really improved since the 1800s?
I don't know. That's what show is setting out to answer. Sorry,
Cameron. Reject modernity, embrace the tradition.
Yes,
tradition of turnip barrels.
Yeah. This is a turnip for the books. Never mind. So well done, Cameron and Baqir. You got the points there for this hideous and heinous crime of flogging turnips without a special bit of paper. So. We are now going to move on to our final question for this first round. Again, news headline, some blanks missing, try and fill them in. So, this is the headline. The latest vogue in blank, gruesome method of blank. I'll read it one more time. The latest vogue in blank, gruesome method of blank.
Fashion. Is the first word fashion?
I'm afraid it is not.
Is the first word justice?
Latest Vogue injustice.
And yeah, I think it might be some new kind of torture devices.
Okay, interesting thought. It isn't. Okay. No, it is. It is not that.
Is it a place?
It is a place, John. Yes.
London.
No.
New York.
No.
Paris.
Yes, it's Paris.
Hey, wow. You guys have jumped in.
Well done, Kamran. Swooping in there. Yes.
The latest Vogue in Paris.
The latest Vogue in Paris. Gruesome method of blank.
Execution. Is it the guillotine?
Oh. It is not. No.
Ah, heck.
Is it related to death?
It is very related to death, but the word itself is not death. Like, the story is about death, but gruesome method of blank is not, if that makes sense.
Is it like, what's the word for preparing someone for death? Like, I don't know what it's called, but like when you put on someone's makeup after they've died.
I don't know what the word is, but I'm afraid it's not, that's not the answer.
And
more obituary, mortician, something.
No, like I say, move away from death for this blank. The blank is nothing to do with death.
Doing makeup or like latest photograph makeup?
No, not a fashion thing, I'm afraid.
That's Paris. That's gruesome method of.
Justice.
I'm afraid not, no.
Government, because it's when they overthrew the king.
No. I'm afraid not.
Is it anything to do with crime and punishment?
I'm afraid not. It is not to do with crime and punishment.
It's training? More, like army training?
No. Interesting thought, but no, I'm afraid that isn't it.
Gruesome method of exercise?
Exercise? No.
Making cheese, making wine.
Making cheese.
Or wine.
No. That would be very funny, though. Latest Vogue in Paris. Gruesome method of making cheese.
They do what to like, work out?
Yeah, you have to put your head into the vat.
Which, of course, is how they make brie. I'm very sorry to our listeners. I hate brie. Anyway.
Don't worry, Joe. Brie happy.
Brie
I have so many cheese jokes, you know. They just get fetter than that, though.
Look, Baqir, don't be immature.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought it was Gouda.
That was a damn good joke.
I can't remember the last time someone ruined my cheese jokes this much.
Oh, dear. I think we're going to get down a black hole if we do this. So we'll put brakes on that. Okay. Although we're okay, move away from where you're thinking. Move towards something a bit lighter. More lighter subject.
Philadelphia.
Not cheese. Sorry, not cheese.
Latest Vogue in Paris. Gruesome method of smoking.
I think you could just leave that at smoking, to be honest. But no, it's not smoking.
Partying.
Okay, you're close with partying.
You're celebrating.
Again, find a different word for
wedding.
That sort of stuff.
Celebrating. Celebrating.
No.
Dancing.
Dancing, no. Those are all things that like you would do for this thing. So it's like it's I don't know really what kind of word this would be, but
not celebrate.
It's old timey, so would it be like make merry?
You're getting closer with make we're getting closer
having
with make merry.
Commemorating.
No, it's not like a specific celebration. Kamran's in the right area. Think talking about like the sort of stuff that you're doing, and that's I'm afraid he hasn't got it yet.
Is it an old timey word?
No, we still use it.
Okay. Also, Tom, we appreciate when you said think a little lighter. I said, "Ha, smoking." I'm not sure anyone wants to mention it.
Sorry,
I was kind of right. Okay.
Okay, where are we thinking?
Okay. In the ballpark of celebrating, but...
Sorry, making merry, having a good time, that sort of stuff.
Relaxing.
Relaxing, no.
vibing.
Vibing?
Going out?
Going out. No, the story is about going out. Think sort of, what are we doing? Clubbing? No, that's not the word.
Meeting friends.
Aha, that's the thing of the past, isn't it?
Yeah.
No, think entertainment. Like,
oh, show. Like pantomime show.
No, again, I'm looking for a word, not like a thing, but think entertainment, think of other words for entertainment. Oh. I feel like I'm kind of handing it to you there, but...
Viewing? No.
No.
I'm going to kick myself so much. Amusement?
Amusement! Cameron, you're exactly right.
Oh, wow.
I don't know why it took me so long to think of another word for entertainment.
Cameron is bang on the money. It is amusement. Well done, Cameron. So the headline is, the latest Vogue in Paris, gruesome method of amusement. But the interesting thing is, John and Baqir, and indeed Cameron as well, you were getting pretty close because it is about a nightclub.
Oh.
I will tell you the story. This is from the Pall Mall Gazette from 1894, and it goes like this. The greatest attraction at the present time is the Cabaret du Néon Brasserie de la Mort. The exterior is just like an ordinary house with the doorway decked out in black for a funeral. On pushing aside the pall, you find yourself in a dimly lit room decorated with funeral ornaments, pictures of dead bodies, skeletons, skulls, and the like. I love how he says, and the like, as if they're like, what else is there? The tables are coffins. When 10 or 15 persons are there, you go down into a vault-like passage and knock at a door which is opened by a monk who shows you into a chapel. In front of the congregation is a coffin. Anyone is invited to step into it and is covered up to the shoulders with a white cloth. The harmonium is played solemnly, the light gradually goes down, and the person in the coffin seems to turn into a skeleton. I suppose it is done with mirrors. Happily for the nerves, there is plenty of laughing. Despite that, it is so terribly realistic that some shudder and turn away. So, for a bit of background, guys, this was a genuine thing in Paris in the 1890s. It was called the Cabaret du Néon, and it was basically a nightclub celebrating death.
I'm not going to lie, that is extremely lit. Like, that sounds so fun. I don't drink or go to clubs, and I'm like, that sounds objectively fun. Like,
yeah. Wikipedia calls this club an early pioneer of the modern theme restaurant. So basically, cat cafes have this place to thank. And then another little thing I found, in a room in this club called the Salle d'Intoxication, which means the intoxication hall.
That's my favorite place.
Oh, yeah. It featured chandeliers made of human bones, customers drinking alcoholic beverages served in cups shaped like human skulls, and sitting at coffin-shaped tables.
Oh, my God, I want to go to this place.
Yeah, this is the most steampunk thing I have ever heard in my life.
See, so hear me out here, right? They definitely had to go and buy those cups shaped like skulls, right? And it's the 1800s, so there's no way it would have been cheaper. There's no way it would have been more expensive to make those cups than it would have been to just like go and take some skulls. Like,
we're going to use real skulls.
I feel like, do you know what I mean? Like, I feel like if you're above the crypt, you'd probably just go take a few skulls and no one would notice.
I wouldn't be too surprised because, you know, it was common practice during the 1890s to buy bodies from mortuaries to take to medical schools and stuff like that. So, yeah, if you went and said, Mr. Christophe, we are inventing this nightclub to celebrate death. I was wondering if we could dig a hole in your lovely graveyard and steal some bones. And he was like, only if I get discount on drinks. And they're like, that sounds fine, my friend. And then I'm very sorry to any French people who are listening.
Which part are you apologizing for?
Let's go with all of it just to cover our bases. Oh man. Yeah, I do agree. This does sound like a really cool night out. But yeah, you can imagine that, because this is a British reporter reporting on this in Paris. And you can imagine how he must be like, oh, goodness me, what in goodness is going on here? And the French were like, hey, just have a nice time, my friend. Sorry again.
I say, this is quite uncouth.
Uncouth, exactly. Oh, man. So, yeah, that is the story. The Paris had a death-themed nightclub, which, frankly, I'm amazed is not still there.
Either we invent a time machine, go back and go to one, or we start up one ourselves right here.
I am up for it. Although, in fairness, Lancaster doesn't really need a death-themed nightclub because we've got Dalton's for that.
Badoom-tish.
Badoom-tish, yes.
We're coming up to Rupert Murdoch now, the Dalton's.
Watch out. We're coming to get you.
Hard-hitting satire. No one is safe.
I was thinking, right, what's worse than a death-themed nightclub? Like, what could possibly be worse? And I realised... a birth-themed nightclub.
I was about to say a nightclub-themed death, but no, you're right. A death-themed birth-themed nightclub.
Actually, you say that, Joe. They had to pass a law in China to stop people from getting strippers for funerals because funeral strippers became a huge thing.
Oh my goodness. My gosh.
That is really horrible. Okay.
What a shame. Is there one if you want to die so we can try it out? Oh no.
Oh my goodness. All right. Well done, guys. That brings us nice and cleanly to the end of the round. So the scores as it stands at the end of this round. Kamran is leading with 3 points. John has 2 points and Baqir has 1 point. However, there is still everything to play for. Since this is only the first round. So well done. I hope we've learned some interesting stuff about the 19th century.
Yes.
So, and basically how mental people were back then. But of course, the 20th century where we're going next is going to be much, much more sane than that. So, a couple of things are going to happen now. We're going to go into a song break between rounds. For those who haven't listened to Talk of the Devil before, every week we have a story of the week, which we announce at the end that the contestants have to try and guess as the game goes on. Each of the song breaks is a clue to the story of the week. And at the end of every song break, I will ask the contestants if they have a guess for what the big story is. And if they get it right, they will win some extra points. However, since we're doing a history-themed episode, the story of the week this week is going to be an on-this-day-in-history fact. So I've done some digging around. I found something important in history that happened on this day, and the song breaks are clues to that event. So that will be what my contestants are trying to guess for. However, just before we move into the first song break, I have a bonus question for my contestants, and I will choose the winner of a point based on the answer to this question. So, guys... I would like you to come up with your own historical-themed restaurant or nightclub. What theme do you choose, and why do you choose it? If anyone says birth, they automatically lose the point.
I told you, it's terrible. It's a joke. I didn't say it because I liked it. I said it because hated it, and I wanted you to suffer what I suffered through.
Fair enough. We definitely did. So, if that's all clear, guys, we're going to go into our first song break, which is Paperback Writer by The Beatles.
Indeed it is.
Fine. Thank you very much.
Alrighty.
Well, short and sweet.
Indeed.
Very sweet indeed. Great song. Welcome back. Welcome back, guys. That was Paperback Writer by The Beatles, and you are listening to Talk of the Devil. So, off the back of that, I'll be very impressed if anyone's got it. Does anyone have any idea what the On This Day in History event is for this week off the back of Paperback Writer?
So, it must be something to do with a book, I'm guessing.
Mm-hmm. Could be.
Is it the birth or death of a famous writer?
It is not, I'm afraid. Kamran, do you have a guess?
So is it to do with a book coming out?
Yes, it is to do with the publication of a book.
Publication of the Bible.
Publication of the Bible.
I meant to say something. I meant to say something else, but the book, that's the only book that came to my mind right now.
Are you looking for some good holiday reading? We have just the book for you.
Imagine, like, you need God. What's a God? Read this book, it'll tell you. I'm Project Bloy. Famous book that came out.
I won't give you long to guess this, because, you know, I want us to keep it going a little bit longer if we can. So if no one has an idea straight off the top of their head of what book it could be, we'll just move straight on with the game. Oh, hello. Baqir's disappeared. Oh, he's back.
Sorry, I wasn't sure if my voice was coming through. Was it Oliver Twist or Sherlock Holmes?
It was not Oliver Twist or Sherlock Holmes. Good guesses, though. Does anyone else have a guess off the top of their head?
Pride and Prejudice?
Pride and Prejudice, no, I'm afraid not.
Is it like a Charles Dickens book?
No, it isn't, I'm afraid. Okay, so good set of guesses, guys, and we are in the ballpark. Think about publications of famous books. But we will now move straight on into our next round, and our next round is called It's Funny Because It's True. In this round, I'm going to read three news stories. I'll read the headline and then I'll read the whole story. And the job of my contestants is to guess whether or not the story really happened or if I made it up myself. As I mentioned just briefly before the song break, this is a 20th century themed round. But I have literally just remembered, I forgot to ask you about your bonus round. So I will quickly retcon everything I just said and we'll go back to the bonus round. So your bonus question was, come up with a historical themed restaurant or nightclub and tell me a little bit about it. And whoever's I think is the best idea will get a bonus point. So who would like to go first?
Oh, I'll happily go first.
All right then, John, let's hear it.
Okay.
My
idea for a historical themed nightclub. Well, first off, the name of this nightclub, it's the Sugar House. And how is it historical? Well, the theme of it is sugar and houses. The nightclub is filled with sweets, historical old sweets, like pear drops and licorice wands and I don't know, stuff like that. I don't know.
It's a fictional.
Oh, that's true. Yes. Well.
Yeah, they're from Harry Potter.
Okay. Well,
I get your point.
J.K. Rowling, her popularity is a thing from history. And where does the house part come in? The nightclub has an estate agent built in, so you can look at houses, and obviously it's before overpopulation, so the property ladder is much easier to climb, so these houses are much cheaper and easier to buy. So yes, thank you very much. The Sugar House nightclub.
Oh wow, thing is, I unironically know so many people who would go to that, like, all the time.
It sounds decent.
Yeah, sounds good. Okay, so we have the Sugar House, sweets and cheap real estate themed nightclub. Very nice. So I'm seeing this kind of being set sort of the historical epoch is sort of the 70s, 80s sort of time.
Yes.
Maybe earlier. Yeah, very nice. Good stuff, John. Who would like to go next?
I'll go next.
Okay, Kamran?
Oh, okay, Kamran.
No, you go.
Okay, so mine would be called The Crossroads. And in essence, what would happen is you'd walk in and you'd get to choose, like, for example, basically some certain easily to put on costume from a certain time period, either, you know, like a kimono or samurai armor or like a, you know, some chainmail or anything from any sort of society. And you get like a brief little bit about who you are and what you are, you know. And you'd basically have to play that sort of character in the bar with your friends or with strangers. Hmm. And so you'd have different bartenders from different eras. And like, for example, they'd purposely not understand what you were saying. For example, if you went and asked for like sake,
and you were Japanese, then, you know, and if it was a Viking bartender that night, then you'd have to do a little bit more explaining about what sake is, you know.
So basically what you have there, Baqir, is LARPing.
In essence, Joe, yes, but I'm trying to make it cooler by adding alcohol.
It works. Okay, was there anything else? Sorry, I feel like I interrupted you there.
No, that's basically it. I feel like I want to allow swords and katanas in the bar, but I also know that's not my idea.
Maybe not.
Or it's a really good idea. I haven't figured it out yet. I'll get back to you.
It could be great reverse psychology. Like, you can have weapons in the bar, and they just don't get used.
True, but I can't imagine a drunk person not wanting to use a katana.
Very good point. Okay, so we have a historical role-playing nightclub, which is made cooler by the fact that it serves alcohol. Very nice, Baqir. And finally, Kamran, what is your plan?
Okay, so the name, it's Amet Tempus, which means fun time in Latin. And it's a sort of Roman-style club slash restaurant. So if one part where we serve the food and we do the classic thing of you eat until you're full and you want to vomit out, then you eat some more. Then we have the actual bar where you can just get absolutely plastered on wine and all the other great drinks that the Romans drank. You know, you do as the Romans do. All roads will eventually lead to the center, which is this Colosseum-esque middle where people can duel or have a duel with animals. It's all very safe. No one actually gets hurt. It's all like, it's performance art. You know, we don't have... it's all staged, and so, like, no one actually gets hurt, no animals actually get hurt. It's purely for the entertainment value. You're all in togas, and there's, like, bouncers all in, like, centurion armor and stick, and this is specifically just for me. I'm carried on, like, a throne by four people with a lot of just, like, a massive goblet of wine and a turkey leg.
Wow. That is really powerful. Okay, so that's amazing, Kamran. Nice. So we have a full-on Romanesque nightclub. We have the Sugar House with vintage suites and vintage real estate options. And then we have Baqir's role-playing place, which they all sound fantastic, I just have to say, and I am struggling to choose a winner. I can see so many of my friends going to all of these. Without irony, I think they would all genuinely go down a storm and you should write those ideas down. However, in terms of the one that I would most want to go to, I think I'm going to choose Kamran's nightclub.
Yay!
Fun times in Latin. I can't remember what the words were, but yeah.
Amet Tempus.
Amet Tempus. That is really, really cool. I do just realize I said that even though people are vomiting on the floor, but you know.
No, they're not vomiting on the floor. They're vomiting like in, there's a certain area you go to where it vomits and it funnels down. So like you're not, I haven't gone full Roman. There's some stuff I had to improve on.
Like Wi-Fi, for example. But yeah, very nice. Yeah, I would absolutely go there. That sounds fantastic. Well done, guys. Those are all great ideas. So
and Cameron's in the lead, but not for long.
Yeah, more we'll have to wait and see. So. As I was saying before I remembered that the bonus round was a thing, we're doing It's Funny Because It's True. I'll read the story. You can tell me if you think it's true or not. We're in the 20th century now. So as I said before, this will be a lot less choleric or lead poisoned than the 19th.
And it'll be war instead.
Sorry?
It'll be war instead.
Yeah, great. Fantastic. So this is our first story. Biting off more than you can chew. Matthias Blau of Chicago persuaded his wife Helen to have all her teeth removed. Then he refused to buy her false teeth because, he said, it was cheaper to feed her on soup than on solid food. Mrs. Blau went to court, was awarded two sets of store-bought teeth and at least a beefsteak per week. Judge Jonas told Mr. Blau that he had committed the meanest trick he had ever heard of. What do we make of that?
What? Can you just imagine? Can you imagine? Like, that would ruin someone's trust entirely. It's like, oh, why don't you trust people? Oh, you know, someone cheated on me. Why don't you trust people? Well, they'll never believe this. But my husband convinced me to get all my teeth removed and then said, have fun gumming.
Oh, my goodness. That would really mess you up.
At least you won the court case, though, right? Like...
I'm leaning towards true, I must say.
Okay.
Because, you know, I don't think it's too out there, because I feel like crazy husbands have done worse things to their spouse.
Henry the Eighth. Henry the Eighth.
That's Menelaus.
Yes, Menelaus, king of Sparta.
Oh wow, what did he do?
He's Helen of Troy's first husband.
Oh, was he the one who kept her sort of locked away, or something like that?
I don't think she was locked away so much as she was just his wife.
Yeah, but what he did do was, when his wife was stolen, ask every single king of every single Greek nation to form the biggest army in the history of the planet to go and destroy one city in Asia Minor.
Oh.
Imagine being that king, like, I need your help. What do you want? My wife's been taken. Okay, so what do you want me to do? Get your army and come with me. Why? Because my wife's been taken. I don't want to.
Well, here's the thing. That is, there. If you watch Troy, that is, there is a scene where exactly that happens.
Great film.
Yeah, it is quite good, yeah. So, John's leaning towards true. Cameron, do you have any thoughts on the story?
I reckon it is... Well, people are terrible, so I can see something like this happening. removing, having a lawyer tooth removed because it's cheaper to feed you on soup? Like, why would you go through with having your teeth removed? Obviously, if it is true, he tricked her to get her teeth removed. But if you're, like, if someone says to you, hey, you should remove your teeth, like, why? Surely you would, like, be hesitant about it unless there's, like, a reason for it, like, unless...
Well, I'd imagine that, like, for example, she probably didn't have very great teeth, and the idea was you can have a perfect set of teeth if you have no teeth, because you can just get dentures, or whatever the teeth replacements are called.
Hmm.
That being said, I don't think there was much anesthetic back then, aside from the good old bonk to the head.
And alcohol.
And cocaine.
I think there was something... There was an early anaesthetic, because remember, this is the early 20th century, not the 19th century.
Ah, so yeah. No, that's true.
There would have been something, but you're right, it probably was just cocaine in a special bottle and not called cocaine.
I think you're referring to Coca-Cola, Joe.
True. Very good point.
I don't know if it's true or not. He was awarded two sets of teeth. I don't know why you'd be awarded two sets of teeth.
You can give one a deep clean and then put the other one in.
Was it like laundry? You just have one set in the wash and you have one set out.
These are my business teeth. This is my party teeth.
They've got sequins on them, or they flash. They're
the chain lines are a little longer for when you go to death-themed nightclubs. You can be a little cooler. I'm leaning towards true.
Okay, because leaning towards true. Cameron, did I get an answer from you?
You did not. I'm going to take true.
Okay. Are you all locking those answers in?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so we all went with true for the evil prick convincing his wife to have all her teeth pulled out. You have all got points.
Yes.
Yes.
That is a completely true story.
How absolutely insane.
Yeah, this is the thing, and I'm not saying this to like deliberately put you off, but what I love so much about doing this round in this themed episode is that the history is so mental that anything could be true or anything could be false, and there's no way of telling.
You've got 100 years of crazy stories to find, whereas in a regular Talk of the Devil episode you only have about a week's worth of crazy stories to find.
Yeah.
So
that's why this is a That's why I came up with this idea. It gives me more scope.
Mm.
But yeah, so that story was from Time magazine, 9th of April, 1928.
Gosh.
And yeah, it's a complete true story. The one thing that the story didn't reveal is how or why he talked her into having all her teeth pulled out. Because like you say, my assumption as well is that she had some kind of medical condition, so she thought it would be a good idea, but it still feels weird.
Well, wasn't the why that it would be cheaper to feed her on soup?
Well, that's what he told her after she had the teeth pulled out. But that's not necessarily the reason why he told her to do it.
Imagine being told that, you know what, I'm sorry, but it would be cheaper to give you baby food than it would real food, so that's just 102.
Yes, exactly. Like, I think that, like, that's the reason why she went to court must have been because this wasn't actually what she wanted. You know what I mean? So I feel like reason is different from the soup thing. But I'll tell you what, this man's logic is absolutely hilarious. I find that really funny. Just that, yeah, it's much cheaper to feed you on soup than whole food.
I can imagine a student reading this and being like, wow, I'm just going to eat soup now. Just because it's just cheaper.
Yeah, because it's cheaper, exactly. Oh, man. Okay, well done, everybody. That's a point to everyone there for the evil man who convinced his wife to have a tea pulled out. But yeah, it's nice that she won the case. So
you reckon that story made it into the Talk of the Devil episode of 1928?
Oh, I'm sure it did. I'm sure it
did. Oh, they didn't actually have podcasts then, just TV and movies. Oh, wait, that was meant to be a historically accurate thing, so it wasn't as funny. My bad.
they had the radio back then. They had wireless radio, yeah. But they
my joke didn't work because I was like, they had something more advanced, but obviously they goddamn didn't ignore me. We'll cut this out.
Yeah, absolutely. Talk of the Devil was actually live back then. It was in the music halls, and you went and watched it live. Okay, well done, everybody. We will move on to our next news story. Is this true or is it a fabrication on my part? The story goes like this. The unfortunate misprint. We here at the New York Hermes would like to extend our apologies to our readership. A misprint in last week's paper, we understand, led to confusion and distress among the people of New York. An article by reporter Michael Carbone claimed that more than 100,000 policemen had been seen at the Hudson River docks the previous day. Their reason for being there was unknown, and many residents of the area were disturbed by the idea that some serious crime or social violence was being committed in the area. We have heard accounts of people fleeing their homes for the week, purchasing handguns, or barricading themselves in their homes. Actually, what Mr. Carbone should have printed was that 100,000 Polish men had gathered at the docks. And in the last week, we have learned they were there as part of traditional Polish St. Stephen's Day celebration. We would like to apologize for the upset. So, what do we think?
I really want to believe it's true. But could you mess up? Like, so I'm wondering, like, let's say this is true, right? It says Polish men instead of policemen. How does that happen? Does he misspell police that badly? Does he mishear police instead of Polish?
Well, it was the other way around. He said policeman when he meant to say Polish.
No, but I'm saying, like, if he missaid it, like, what caused him to say that? Do you know what I mean? Because he was typing it out. So it wasn't just a typo. It was like he typed that. Well, it was, but he looks at it and he's like, that's right. Do you know what I mean?
Hmm.
So that when someone told him, I saw 100,000 Polish men, did he hear policemen? Or did he, like, mistype policemen as Polish men? Or mistype Polish men as policemen?
Maybe his Microsoft Word predictive text gave him policemen.
Well, Grammarly wasn't out then, so it's very likely.
Yeah, he had one of those tech voice-to-text recorders, and it just got mixed up.
Well, it's used to the old accent. It's used to the transatlantic accent, and he didn't have it. Okay, policemen, see, you need to...
Policemen, see, they're all down the dock, see? That's my favourite accent.
Yeah.
I don't think it's true.
You're going with false, okay.
Well, I also don't know why Polish men would like to celebrate at the docks. Like,
yeah, I mean, it is true that St. Stephen's Day is a big thing in Poland.
Right, yes.
But I also know you do your research if you're making this up, Joe, so...
Cameron, do you have anything to say?
We haven't I think that... See, I originally was going to say St. Stephen's Day isn't a thing, because if there's a saint called Stephen, that's just weird. But then you just said it's a real thing, so now I'm thinking you may have double bluffed me here.
Ah.
Why do you think Stephen's a weird name?
For a saint, like, come on, for a saint, like...
I mean, there's a saint, like, for basically every name that, like, you know, there's a Saint Simon, you know, it's...
I'm gonna look that up after the show.
Okay.
Because Saint John. Okay, no, Saint John is a thing. Saint Joe, for example, or Saint Baqir, or Saint Cameron, or Saint, you know, whatever.
Well, there's a Saint Joseph.
Yeah, there's a Saint Joseph.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure there would be a Saint John. I feel like there probably.
Oh, yeah, there's definitely Saint John.
Yeah, there is a Saint John. I don't know. That's just the first one that I like.
you're in a call with him.
You know what? I really rate the self-confidence, John. I truly do.
But remember, don't lose your head.
I am sticky. I'm going to say it's false.
Okay, Cameron's going to say it is false. John, do I have an answer from you?
I'm going to say false. Yes.
Okay, we've all got the same answers again. Are you locking those answers in?
Yes.
Okay, then. Well, I can tell you that misreading or mistyping Polish men for policemen and causing widespread panic in New York City is actually false. I did make that story up. So once again, you all have the point.
I knew Stephen wasn't a real saint.
He is. That I don't believe it.
Wait. Is he Stephen the saint with a V or a PH?
PH.
Maybe PH. Just more like biblical, I guess.
Well, yeah, because Saint Stephen's the bloke who got stoned to death. And I love the fact that Cameron, even though this is a story about a New York journalist who listened to someone say Polish men, heard policemen, wrote policemen, showed it to his editor, was believed, printed it, and then caused widespread panic in New York City. The thing you didn't believe is that there is a saint called Stephen.
I also didn't believe that the newspaper would apologize for like anything.
Oh, I see.
Oh, no. If they did that, I feel like they would. I feel like newspapers generally do apologize if they do something that bad.
Yeah, it is kind of a, I think it is practice. And I have to be honest.
The only thing you don't believe about these stories are true things, Cameron.
Look, okay, I'm getting points. That's all that matters.
No, why? For the idea of this story, I stole something that I heard on QI, which was there was an Australian newspaper that did print an apology. So it is a thing that happens.
Okay.
Because their previous week's issue had claimed that 30,000 pigs had fallen into a river and were floating down it. But what they actually should have put was 30 sows and pigs. So that this kind of thing does... A sow, female pig.
Oh, there's a name for that?
Yeah.
Huh. Yeah.
There's also a saint called Stephen, man.
Liar.
Cameron is learning so much today.
Wait, there's an Australia? What?
I don't. Yeah, it's like a big prison.
Occasionally, they let one out for good behaviour, and that's how you get Hugh Jackman. No, Hugh Jackman's from Australia.
Okay, I learned so much.
Yeah. Okay, so well done, guys, once again, you all get the points right. Fantastic. So we only have one more question in this round. We have one more news story from the 20th century. So this is how it goes. A memorable send-off. In Manville, New Jersey, boisterous wedding guests pelted Joseph Leuker. I think I'm pronouncing that right. I apologize if I'm not. Boisterous wedding guests pelted Joseph Leuker and his new wife with rice. As they left the church, a mystery person, perhaps a wedding guest, perhaps a passerby, knocked Loika unconscious with a 5-pound bag of rice. Luckily, no permanent harm was done. Loika was revived, and he and his bride set off on their honeymoon. So, what do we think?
Wait. So he threw it away, just like knocked him out by like swinging it at his face.
I don't know. You tell me, Baqir.
Well, Joe, I'm not the one who made this story up. I know people throw rice at weddings. I can't imagine anyone would just lob a 5-pound bag of rice at someone. Well, no, I can. I would do it. Did you say 5 pounds?
5 pound, yeah.
I think this is false. Because that's like 2.5 kilos. And I feel like it would take more to knock out someone.
If you hit him on the head, then yeah. If they fall, if you hit him on the head and they fall, and then they hit the head on the way down, that's a KO.
A baseball bat doesn't weigh that much.
That's true. There's a lot of force behind it. I guess also so in the story that may or may not be created fraudulently by Joseph here.
Yeah.
He threw it, or what did he do with the rice?
Interesting question.
Like you're saying he knocked him out with a 5-pound bag of rice.
Mm-hmm.
What's the situation? Like, how did he knock him out with a 5-pound bag of rice?
I'm not telling you any more than what I've just read out.
Can you repeat that bit, please?
He made him cook the rice and eat all the rice until he was unconscious.
Put him in a food coma.
Yeah.
Have you guys seen Kung Fu Panda 2, that bit where Tigress says to Po, I hope this works out better than your plan to cook rice in your stomach by eating it raw and then drinking boiling water? If you want me to reread that bit, I will. As they left the church, a mystery person, perhaps a wedding guest, perhaps a passerby, knocked Loika unconscious with a 5-pound bag of rice.
Unrelated to the story, when the first Kung Fu Panda film came out, there was a big debate in China on if Westerners make better historical films about China than China do.
Even though they're animals.
Yeah, what?
You know, like apart from them being animals, like a historical thing.
Oh.
Well, I don't think Kung Fu Panda is historical, Kamran.
Okay, no, but like, okay, you know what I mean? How ancient China was,
and the animals. Yeah, Chinese culture, and I remember this. So I'm just messing with you.
No, I'm interesting.
One of these days, Baqir. One of these days.
you didn't get a 5-pound bag of rice.
Yes, to the head. Okay, so does anyone have an opinion, a solution, anything?
So it didn't say why he did it.
No, it didn't.
I'm going to say false, because I feel like it would have came out that he was like an ex-lover of one of the people.
Okay, Cameron's going to say this story is false. Baqir or John, anyone jump in?
I'm going to say true, because I feel like you can't really make it up. I feel like I've got to say, if I were sitting writing a Talk of the Devil script and thinking, what made up story can I make? I don't think a man knocking somebody over with a bag of rice would really spring to mind. So yes, I'm going to say it's true.
Okay, then.
I don't know because I don't really like. And Cameron's reasoning is great. No offense, Cameron. It's just I'm not sure that's enough. But offense taken or offense meant. But also on the other hand, John, Joe's a creative writing student, and I feel like he would have seen something like this and come up with it.
I love it when people say that sort of stuff when I host Talk of the Devil. It's like, I don't trust you. You're a creative writer.
Does it say what city this happened in, or what country?
Pardon?
Does it say the city or country this happened in?
This happened in Manville, New Jersey, so it's America.
I mean, those Americans, those Yanks, you know.
Apparently, the... Sorry?
I was said I'm going to go for false, but I would like to hear this fact.
I was just going to say that apparently the guy thought he was a policeman because of a misprint in the paper and twatted him with a bag of rice.
Okay. On St. Stephen's Day.
On St. Stephen's Day, precisely. Which exists.
With a PH.
With a PH, yes. Okay, so are you all locking those answers in? John has said true, and Kamran and Baqir have both said false.
Yes, I'm locking it in.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I can reveal that the man who was leaving his wedding got knocked out with a bag of rice. That actually happened.
Yes.
That is a true story.
Yes.
It's from Time Magazine from the 26th of November 1934, and the thing is, to all your questions, I don't know the answers. I don't know if the guy threw the bag or just twatted him with it. I don't know if he knew the guy. I don't know where the guy came from. It just happened.
So I can still hope that he really knocked him out by making him eat the rice.
Exactly.
We can even get more creative. Maybe he fed it to a bunch of raw rice to a bunch of pigeons and tie those pigeons to that guy.
Mm.
just 20th century prank patrol.
Yes. Hey, you've been pranked by the prank patrol, kid.
He's just knocked out, like, not moving.
We're not real policemen, we're Polish men. Ha ha.
Happy St. Stephen's Day, son. Okay, well done, guys. Well done, John, particularly. So that has brought us to the end of this round, our second round of the game. There is only one round, full round, rather, left to go. Well done. You guys did really well. Once again, the past is bloody insane.
Yeah.
So we're going to go into another song break, another clue for our This Day in History story. Again, remember, it's the publication of a famous book. Before we move into the song break, scores. The scores at the moment stand thusly. Kamran is on 6 points and still in the lead.
Yeah.
John is on 5 points, very close behind. And Baqir is on 3 points, bringing up the rear. But again, still to play for, could still get there. So, well done, guys, again. Your bonus question for this song break. I would like you to each come up with a theory for why someone would want to knock out the groom with a bag of rice. That is your bonus question. So we've just been discussing the story. I was really hoping you weren't going to start speculating because that is your bonus question. So yeah, I want you to come up with a theory as to why this happened, and I will give the bonus point to the best answer. Without further ado, we will move into our next song break, which is Red Right Hand by Nick Cave and the Bad Seed. Thank you very much.
Yes. Just need to cue it. Come on. Awesome.
Is that a Peaky Blinders theme?
I think so.
Howdy.
Hey, I like Nick Cave. He's cool.
Very exciting.
Yeah. Have any of you guys seen The Proposition?
I have not.
I have not.
No, me neither.
Yeah, well, it's a film. It's a like sort of Australian. It's like an Australian Western, and Nick Cave wrote the full score and the soundtrack, and it's really, really great. And I think you guys will like that film. Anyway, well, I digress. But still, good movie. So, welcome back, guys. Hope you've enjoyed that little song break. So, just before the break, I asked. I'll ask first of all. Does anyone have any more ideas about the big news story?
I'm thinking
off the back of Paperback Writer and Red Right Hand.
Is it to do with the release of Edgar Allan Poe's Mask of the Red Death?
That's an interesting guess. I'm afraid it's not correct, but
okay.
Not a bad guess.
Poe related?
Sorry?
Is it related to Edgar Poe?
Not really, I'm afraid.
Okay, then my guesses aren't good.
Still, interesting thought process.
Yeah. I'm thinking...
Any other ideas?
I'm thinking right hand might have something to do with writing a book. But yes.
Okay, right hand. Baqir, any ideas?
Well, so I'm trying to think whether it's like, whether it's like, because at first I thought like it was, I didn't really pay attention, so I was like red right hand, maybe it's about like war or something. Now I'm thinking it's about the devil. Was it the date Dr. Faustus was published?
Ooh, that's another interesting thought. I'm afraid that's not it. A couple of good stories and good ideas you come up with there, Kamran and Baqir, but I'm afraid it is not the publication of Mask of the Red Death or Dr. Faustus.
Dang.
Okay, but interesting.
Have you guys ever seen Samurai Jack?
I'm afraid I have not.
It's on all four. It's very good, but like the episodes vary from like tone so much. So there's like a serious episode where he has to like get past this tower for the archers, but they're like the best archers in the world, but turns out they're blind, so he has to like tie a cloth around his eyes so he can't see, but like he can be on their level. And then there's an episode where he gets turned into a chicken.
Right.
I think you'd really enjoy Samurai Jack, Joe.
Yeah, it's about a lot of history, because he's like he's a samurai, but he's trained with like Mongols and Shaolin monks and Vikings and knights, and it's so good.
Well, that, and also like I feel like the comedy style is very similar to what you'd like as well.
Oh yeah.
And the end, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I will take that recommendation on board. Thank you very much.
Oh yeah, he does train with them. I remember he trained with Spartans one episode.
So he'd fit right in at your historical themed nightclub, Baqir.
He did. Unfortunately, we had to close down because we didn't. We recreated Greek fire. Oh. Unfortunately, yeah, we lost the recipe again after it burnt down.
Rookie mistake. Anyway, yeah. Well done, guys. Cool. So now I will ask for your answer to your bonus question from before the song break, which was, why, in God's good name, why would someone try and knock out someone at their wedding with a bag of rice? Anyone can go first. What did you come up with for a theory?
I can go first, if people want.
Yeah, sure, please do.
So a lot of people, Joe, a lot of people, people named John, people named Kamran, they might say, well, it was for vengeance. And I would agree. But I think it's more than that. See, a lot of crimes that are committed, especially in the 18th and 19th century, were very symbolic. People had more going on then. And I think the rice means something. I think that these guys were friends together in primary school, right? Mm-hmm. And when they were like growing up, they wanted to get rich. And obviously, what was the best way to get rich in America, whatever time period you said this was in? Rice farming, right? And of course, it didn't go well. And they had a lot of droughts and a lot of problems and a lot of crop failures. And eventually, they did make it. He was stabbed in the back by this guy, right? Who then took all the rice to the rice harvest, which I'm assuming is how rice works.
Yeah.
And so then he goes off and gets married, being the rich, successful rice farmer he is. And so this man, in his anger, you know, rice bags him. But he only uses a 5-pound bag of rice. Is it because he can't carry a bigger like rice bag? No, he's been a rice farmer for 20 years. He's incredibly strong. But he still loves his brother, even if he did get stabbed in the back.
That is a very moving story.
Thank you.
Like some people say that this is just a comedy panel show. It's not. We come up with some really sort of affecting material here. But yeah, that's a good idea. That I really like that thought. So it was a revenge thing for like something that happened way back. I like how you said that it was crimes in the 18th and 19th century, but this happened in 1934.
But I wasn't sure when you said it happened, and I was like, oh, whatever it did.
That's all right, that's fine. But yeah, good story, like the sound of it. Cool, who would like to go next?
I'll go next, if that's okay. Cool with John.
Cameron, go ahead.
So now, in the 1930s, reading wasn't a big thing. You know, a lot of America was illiterate. So this man stumbled upon an early draft of The Iceman Cometh and misread it as The Rice Man Cometh. And he was trying to be the rice man and run up to people and throw rice at them. And so that's just what happened here.
That's what
sad
happened.
It's a sad case of illiteracy.
Illiteracy and delusion.
Yeah.
That's the interesting idea again. So we have a nutter who thinks he's the rice man coming to bestow rice. Very
right
cool.
The Iceman.
And finally, John, what is your theory?
My idea for his motive for knocking this man out is this wedding guest, the groom of the wedding.
Yeah.
He has got a wedding ring on him now, but this wedding ring, unlike most wedding rings, is not so tightly affixed to his finger as it would be on most married people, because he's only just put the wedding ring on. So it should be a lot easier to slide off his finger than the wedding rings of most people. This man bought a bag of brown rice. He originally bought it to cook it, but he found out that cooking brown rice is a lot harder than cooking white rice. We shall ignore the fact that historically white rice probably hadn't been introduced to the country in 1934. But yes, so he had this brown rice just lying around, and he was like, well, I've got to put it to good use. Waste not, want not. I know, go mug a wedding guest. So yes, that was what happened. And then he used some of the starchy leftover water from his cooking to lubricate the man's finger when he was sliding the ring off it. That was what he did.
Okay, so this was a theft. It was a theft. Mm. A brazen daylight robbery. Okay, those are all very interesting ideas. So we have revenge for a lost rice business. We have the rice man cometh, and we have a mugging gone right. It sounds as if it worked. Mm. Again, I could. The fact is, it could be any of them. We don't know what happened. But I am going to award the point to Baqir and his vengeful rice brothers. I don't know, it touched me deep inside. Moving.
You know, maybe a nice man cometh.
A nice man, very good. Oh, great. That was the guy who brought him round afterwards. The nice man. Okay, well done, guys. Another good set of little bit of imagination there from you. Very nice. So, everybody, we're going to move into our final round, full round for the episode. This is a round I have developed myself, especially for our historical theme thing. Now, for anyone who knows me, or indeed anyone who doesn't know me, because I'm about to say this on a podcast, so everyone who listens will find out, even if they don't know me. That was a very long-winded way of saying something. I am a huge fan of the classic period of Hollywood, sort of 1930s up to the 1960s. Love all movies, well, not all movies, but I love movies from that period. So this round is called Reviews You Lose. I have been digging through online resources of the movie magazines of the 30s, 40s, and 50s, and I have been finding reviews from classic films. And what I'm going to do is read out a review from a classic movie, and your guys' job is to guess what movie I am describing. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Very good. So there's not really that much else to it. You'll get a point if you get it right. Afterwards, I'll talk a little bit about the trivia of the film, because any opportunity to learn a bit about movies from me, I'm happy with. Movie nights with you. Hey?
So this is from the 30s to the 60s. That's our movie period.
Yes. If that's any help to you, yes. I have actually realized, because what I did when I was planning the other rounds was, like, the 19th century round, I made sure that the stories were in order of when they happened. It's like 1959, 1980 something, and 1890 something. And then I did the same thing for the American round. I've realized that every single question in this whole episode actually goes in chronological order.
Oh, nice. Wow.
Quite exciting. Yeah. These movies are not only from a specific period, but they are sequential, if you see what I mean. So, this is our first movie review. Miss Judy Garland, with whom MGM have been making a valiant effort these several years, has done pleasantly well with much the most demanding part she has had. She comes through neatly alongside such older and time-seasoned able performers as Frank Morgan, Ray Bolger, Burt Lahr, and Jack Haley. What film is that a review for?
The Wizard of Oz.
Yes, Baqir, exactly right, straight off the mark. What? It is the Wizard of Oz.
Oh, wow, bloody hell.
Yeah, my well, God.
You're not in Kansas anymore, sunshine. No, yes, exactly. It's a review for The Wizard of Oz, the classic MGM 1939 musical about a little girl called Dorothy who ends up in a land which is meant to be beautiful, but actually freaking everything in it wants to kill her. Here's a few little fun trivia facts.
It's like Australia.
Yeah,
so it's like Australia.
Yeah, precisely. That's why it's called Oz. Here's a few little fun trivia things I found about the film. Some studies suggest that it's one of the most watched movies of all time. I think the current IMDb list puts it at the third most watched movie in history.
Oh, wow. Is it like the original or is it the Muppets version?
Yeah, but this is, I'm talking classics, Cameron, so of course it's the Muppets version.
Yeah, I just want to make sure.
Which
wait, what are the first two movies?
Sorry?
What are the first two movies?
Number one was Titanic, and I can't remember the second one. I didn't look that carefully, to be honest, but I'm a little bit gutted that Titanic is the most watched film in history, apparently.
Not a good film.
Yeah. For this film, Judy Garland won a juvenile Oscar, which is smaller than a regular Oscar, and for the rest of her life, she called it the Munchkin Award, which is adorable. And then this is a genuinely true fact about The Wizard of Oz that blows my mind. When the costume department were looking for a coat for the wizard to wear, they chose one from a charity shop. Later, they found out that exact coat had belonged to the man who wrote the book of The Wizard of Oz.
That's scary.
It's really scary and it's weird. Yeah, genuinely true story. So, yeah. Well done, Baqir. The answer for that question was The Wizard of Oz. Have you all seen The Wizard of Oz?
Yes.
Yes.
A while ago. Very
yeah.
Good. I don't think I've actually seen the original, to be honest.
You should. It's beautiful. I went to see The Wizard of Oz and a special re-release at the cinema because I was going to study it for part of one of my courses. And I went to see it. And I have to be honest with you, I'm one of those people who, when I sit in the cinema, I see people coming in like big crowds of people with loads of snacks or big families, and I just go, oh, Jesus Christ, this is going to be so noisy. Could you all just leave? And such a thing was happening. I was there, loads of groups of people coming in. They were chatting. They were talking. They were on their phones. I was furious. Then the film started, and they went completely silent. That's how good of a film The Wizard of Oz is.
I don't mind how much noise you make in a film before I do any ads and trailers and stuff. But once the film starts, quiet, you know, just
yes,
chill.
I couldn't agree more.
I've never been in a movie theater where people are making a lot of noise during the film unless they actually need to. Like, unless they're, like, getting into their seats or, like, leaving. Do you know what I mean? But I've never heard people just having a loud conversation.
I've had it a couple of times. It's worse in theaters, in my experience, than it is in cinemas. But yeah, I'm one of those people who has my eye on everyone just in case it happens.
I feel like if I went to like a cinema or a theatre with you, Joe, I'd be scared to like tell you I'm just going to go to the toilet because you'd shout at me.
No, I wouldn't shout at you because then I'd be part of the problem, wouldn't I?
It's like when you shush someone in the library louder than they're talking.
Yeah.
there's a cinema in, I think it's London, where they have shushing ninjas. So it's these guys in like black morph suits just going around shushing people.
I've seen that. That's amazing.
Oh, sick.
Yeah, I love that job. Just before we move on to the next question, there's a little personal story for me about The Wizard of Oz. My granddad, who of course being my granddad, was a child when The Wizard of Oz came out, went to see it at the cinema. And for those of you who don't know, The Wizard of Oz, the first part of the movie is in black and white. And then when she gets to the Land of Oz, it's in color. Yeah. And my granddad went to see this movie and he came home and his mum said, how was the film? And he said, I saw two movies, because he thought they were two separate films. Yeah, which is, again, fundamentally quite a cute thing to say. Okay, so...
Another fun fact is, they used different actresses for the black and white portion of the film and the colour portion. Because of the lighting of the different portions was very, very different. They had to have extremely bright lights for the colour portion because it was shot in Technicolor. But yes, they used different actresses for the different parts.
Is that really true?
I believe it is. I'm worried I might have accidentally spread horrible misinformation in this Talk of the Devil episode. But
which is all about the truth.
Oh yeah.
But yeah, now I've not heard that. I was under the impression it was Judy Garland throughout. One thing I do know is there is a moment where they do use two different actors for Dorothy, and it's when she goes from black and white to colour because they did it all in one shot.
Oh, that might be it.
Yeah, what they did was, because they were filmed, it's weird because they made the set that she was in before she's in colour look black and white and had a different actress in a black and white costume. Film that, the camera goes past her into the colour world, and then the actual Judy Garland walks into the scene. That's what I've been led to understand.
I think right.
I'm not just shooting down what you said, it's just I've never heard that before. So well done, Baqir. There's a point for you there. It is The Wizard of Oz. So we'll move on to our next movie. So producer-director George Stevens has turned out here a story of the American frontier that establishes a new high for workers in that field of fiction or fact to strive for. Alan Ladd, who plays an itinerant horseman, undisposed toward telling his past, but quick to unholster his lightning guns in his friend's behalf, hasn't had a part as good for him as this one. The film has in it considerable shooting, all of it fatal, and a good deal of fistic fighting. Genuine quote. And I just feel like telling the guy, yes, it's a Western. What were you signing up for?
That reminds me of one of my favorite reviews. I think Godzilla got Monsters versus Gods or some Godzilla movie. And someone complained that I had too many monster fights.
Oh, that's the worst guy.
And it's like, what were you expecting?
Even though the only reason that movie was made was because people said there weren't enough monster fights in the last one. Okay, so does anyone have any ideas about this movie? Any thoughts?
What's the name of the actor again?
Alan Ladd.
Oh my god, I know it, but I don't know.
Okay.
Come on, Kamran. I'll help you remember.
Come back to me. I'm swimming in the void.
yeah, it's probably slightly less well known than The Wizard of Oz. Well, it is definitely less well known than The Wizard of Oz.
Alan Ladd. I'm trying to think if I know, like, because a lot of the films I know only really stretch back to the 70s and 80s.
Uh-huh.
Like, even when I think of Westerns, the oldest I can think of is, like, The Good, The Bad, and The Ugly. Like,
yeah, that is a little bit late.
It's not the Dollars trilogy.
I feel like you do know this, Cameron, but I'll give you
a little bit. I do, but I don't, because like ask you others. I'm gonna.
John or Baqir, any?
Literally none.
Yeah. Sorry.
Okay. If I say that the title of the movie is the main character's name.
Okay, I know it.
Yeah, go on.
Shane.
Well done. Fantastic. I was genuinely worried no one was going to know what Shane was. Well done, Cameron. Very well done,
Lee. At uni, I watched like The Good, The Bad, The Ugly, like, and The Dollars Trilogy. And I was like, I want to watch more Westerns from this time. And I watched Shane.
Yeah. So, well done, Cameron. It's a great movie. It's for those of you who don't know, basically, Shane is to Westerns what Dracula is to vampires. Like, it's basically the archetypal Western. The idea is that Shane is a mysterious man who rides into a town out of nowhere. And it just so happens that this town is having serious problems with richer people who don't live very far away, who are trying to run them off their land. And Shane basically goes, hang on a minute. I happen to be the most dangerous man on the planet. And I've just shown up at a time when people need help. And then, as our esteemed reviewer says, there is considerable shooting, all of it fatal. And I won't spoil the ending.
I said, don't you mean that we could just shoot rich people to solve our problems?
Oh boy, Shane, the parable for our times, absolutely. Shane is a Paramount film from 1953. It was actually filmed in 1951, but it took 2 years to edit, which I find quite amusing. It was released just 1 year after High Noon, which is kind of the other archetypal Western movie. And here's another little fun story about it. Alan Ladd, who we've spoken about a couple of times, he plays Shane, was only 5'6". And because, of course, in movies, you're not allowed to have short actors. Alan Ladd had to film all his scenes on platforms, or if they couldn't use platforms, everyone else had to stand in a hole to make him look taller. There were stories of Alan Ladd movies where the director had to dig trenches in the floor for the actors to walk through to make them look shorter than Alan Ladd. So, yeah, that's Shane. Well guessed, Kamran.
Fun fact, because I'm a wrestling fan, and in wrestling, the interviewers are usually women, so, like, the height doesn't really matter, but sometimes they have, like, a man interview some of the wrestlers, and obviously the interview is supposed to be smaller than the wrestlers, so sometimes they get the interviewer to, like, stand, like, wide-legged, so they look shorter compared to the wrestlers.
You have to giraffe splay to talk to a wrestler. That's
yeah.
Same basic deal. Very well done.
I want to rewatch Shane. I think it's on that is on Netflix.
It's probably not on Netflix. As a rule, generally, if you want to find a movie on Netflix, it's not there. That's my experience.
Netflix only has movies you weren't planning to watch.
Exactly. I've literally never heard a truer word spoken. That is exactly right. But yeah. Absolutely, Shane is a great movie, and if you haven't seen it, I do encourage you to watch it and read the book. The book is excellent. So, well done, Kamran. Point for you there. So, we will move on to our third film review. Let's see if you can guess this one. The film opens at the Plaza Hotel in New York, rushes through the Midwest, and ends up under George Washington's chin on Mount Rushmore Memorial in South Dakota. Through all that startling scenery, Cary Grant runs like mad from a murderous band of international spies. The result is a satisfying mixture of chilling suspense and nervous giggles, which is the essence of Hitchcock's art. It's a little bit of a clue on the end there. What do we reckon?
Psycho?
It's not Psycho.
That's the only Hitchcock film I know.
Okay. Yeah, good for getting in there. But yeah, I'm afraid it isn't Psycho. I almost put Psycho in this round, but I didn't.
The one with the birds? Is it Crows?
It's called The Birds.
Oh, just The Birds. Is it Birds?
It is not The Birds, no.
Oh. Hitchcock films.
John, any thoughts?
I'm afraid I must echo Baqir. The only Hitchcock film I know is Psycho.
Okay.
Oh, dear.
Okay, so it's Mount Rushmore is quite significant. There's a very famous scene in this film filmed on Mount Rushmore.
Is it like a katana fight scene on top of Mount Rushmore?
I'm afraid not. That would be awesome, and I want That'd to watch right. it happen, but no. Right. I don't think the idea of what a katana was had reached Hollywood by this time.
Does he climb on Mount Rushmore and starts picking the nose of one of the presidents?
He does not pick the nose. He does climb on Mount Rushmore, although there is a story that Hitchcock wanted to film a scene where Cary Grant hides inside Abraham Lincoln's nose and then gets a sneezing fit. There's also a famous scene where he runs away from a plane.
In the cornfield.
Yeah, in the cornfield, yeah.
Is it north by something?
Ooh, north by northwest. Anyone?
John, yes. You absolute you scoundrel.
In fairness, Kamran, in the Christmas episode, he kept having his answers nicked, so I think it is only fair that I've given on the point this time. Yes, but well done to both of you. Genuinely very well done. It is North by Northwest. Well guessed. North by Northwest is an MGM film, again, from 1959. It's a kind of spy thriller. With a lot of people say that without it, we wouldn't really have had the Sean Connery, James Bond movies. They would have looked very different. It was tied for the sixth highest grossing film of 1959, which now I read it out loud, isn't that impressive really, but it's, you know, not inconsiderable. There's also a thing where there's a scene of it filmed in a forest, and because it would have been too expensive to fly to the forest and film there, Alfred Hitchcock planted 100 pine trees in a studio soundstage. because that's when you're Alfred Hitchcock, you can do that.
Oh wow!
Yeah, and yeah, my last trivia fact is when it came time to edit the final film, because obviously at this time all films were shot on rolls of film, and so how much was cut was measured in feet. Less than 8 feet of film was cut from this movie in the final edit. And 8 feet of film is about 5 seconds in movie time. So after filming the whole movie, they only cut 5 seconds of it.
Wow.
Wow. Yeah, it's pretty impressive, that, isn't it?
Bloody hell.
Yeah, I watched the movie for the first time at New Year, and I really recommend it to anyone who hasn't seen it. It's amazing.
I'm going to cut more from this Talk of the Devil episode than that.
You're exactly right. There's going to be more than 5 seconds. Exactly. That's the thing to think about. There is more missing. There are more deleted scenes from this Talk of the Devil episode than there are from Alfred Hitchcock's classic film, North by Northwest. I think, actually, speaking of Psycho, this was the movie he made before Psycho.
Oh. Wow. Mm. Interesting.
Yeah, well, I guess, John. Yeah, brilliant. Fantastic. So, with that, we will move on to our final film review of this round. And then after that, we've got one more song break. And then the only thing left to do is check up on the This Day in History story. So, I will now read you our final film review. The New York scene has captured the imagination of our movie makers. Once again, the madding metropolis with its myriad malfunctions is the montage of the plot, which is the most 1950s, 1960s sentence I've ever read in my life. It plays itself out with the smooth softness of an article in the slick magazines come to life. This sophisticated comedy is an exciting entry with its measure of pleasurable entertainment. Audrey Hepburn, known better for her portrayal of nuns, ladies of nobility, women of gentility, is the capricious heroine. Sorry, excuse me. She comes through convincingly and adorably as the skinny symbol conceived by Truman Capote. What movie is this?
I know, I have no idea.
I feel like you might do. You just need to give it a bit more thought.
That's what I'm thinking. Like, I feel like it's very. I feel like it's probably very famous.
Yeah. So, this is one of those movies you don't have to have seen to have heard of.
Well, I feel like I won't remember it until I hear it, which is my issue.
Yeah.
Was a song made about the film?
Yeah.
Is it Breakfast at Tiffany's?
Yes, it is Breakfast at Tiffany's, Cameron. Well done. Brilliant. Yes, guys, it is Breakfast at Tiffany's, which is a Juro, Shepherd and Spinell production. It's like an independent studio from the time, from 1961. As we said, Audrey Hepburn starred in the movie, and actually her salary for this film was, let me get this right, $750,000, which, as near as I can work out, is about $6 million today.
Damn.
And that made her, at the time, the highest paid actress per movie. Currently working.
Wow.
Yeah, that being said, George Peppard, who plays her love interest in the film, only agreed to be in the film because he was told his character was the hero. Which I find is just hilarious. They could only get this guy if he thought he was the hero. He isn't, by any means. And then here's one last fun little fact for you. There are two actors in this movie who are also the voice actors who played Fred Flintstone and Barney Rubble in The Flintstones.
Oh, Audrey Hepburn was Fred Flintstone.
Sorry?
Audrey Hepburn was Fred Flintstone.
Oh, yeah, she was a gifted actress. Like, there's never been anyone else like her. So, really.
I mean, that's a little Easter egg in Breakfast at Tiffany's where she runs, where the car she gets in has no floor. And she says, yabba dabba do.
Yeah, exactly. There's lots of nods to the Flintstones throughout Breakfast at Tiffany's if you watch it very carefully.
Audrey Hepburn. She's going to have some Breakfast at Tiffany's. Sorry,
that's perfect.
No, I don't. See, I was going to guess dinner at Judy's. It's obviously very
dinner
far
at
off.
Judy's. That's the last film in the trilogy. The one in the middle is called Lunch at Tracy's. Brilliant. And of course, the voice actor who played Barney Rubble in The Flintstones was actually Mel Blanc, who created the voices of basically every Looney Tunes character.
Wow.
Yeah. It's called The Man of 100 Voices. Very cool man. So, well done, Cameron.
The Man of 100 Voices sounds like a spirit that would haunt you in a dark forest.
Yeah, it does a little bit, doesn't it?
There's thank a very... Sorry.
You first.
Thank you. There's a very interesting clip of the actor who voices Bugs Bunny pretending to be the duck, and the voice actor who voices the duck trying to be Bugs Bunny. And I remember like seeing voice actors from The Simpsons talk about that clip. Says, yeah, if, as a voice actor, that's the like hardest thing to do is to voice a character and try and make it sound like a different character, if that makes sense.
Wow, that's so, like, really cool.
Yeah, so like the guy who voiced Homer is like, oh, I tried to do Homer trying to be Grandpa, but it just came out as him being Grandpa.
Yeah, that's really cool. That it is interesting.
Mm.
There's also a story that Mel Blanc...
It's like voice acting. Hmm? I was like, this is voice acting Inception, right?
Yes, exactly. It is voice acting Inception. There's a story about Mel Blanc where he was in a car accident and he was in hospital. Unconscious on the bed, and a friend came in, and no one had been able to get him to say anything until the friend leant over and went, "Bugs, can you hear me?" And Mel Blanc answered in Bugs Bunny's voice.
Oh, wonderful.
Which is really creepy, but yeah, pretty cool. So, well done, guys. That takes us to our film reviews. I hope you've enjoyed this little trip down memory lane, and if they're not memories, if they're things you've never seen, go see them. They're great movies. So, we now draw to the end of our third and final round. Like I said, we have one more song break, one more bonus question, and then we will learn what happened on this day in history. Presumably a lot of stuff happened, but only this specific thing today. So before we go to our song break, this is your bonus fact. For anyone who was on the Christmas special episode, this is quite similar to one of the ones we did then. So what I want you to do is I would like to hear a film fact from you guys, a bit of film trivia. The most interesting fact will win a point. However, if the winner of the point made up the fact and I still believed them, they win 2 points.
I just remembered from the Christmas episode.
So we've got to make up a fact.
Yeah, well, try it. If you can't make up a fact, come up with a really interesting one and it might still win. But if you can, make up a fact that I will believe and find interesting.
Okay.
That is your bonus question challenge for this song break. And we're going to move into the kind of song break that I've never actually seen before, really. The song we're playing is the classic single from epic rap battles of history, Rasputin versus Stalin.
Oh, great one.
Oh, I know this off by heart. I'm not going to mute myself. So I don't.
Yeah, you know. Same. I know off by heart as well.
Fair enough. Have fun, guys. And I will see you afterwards. I miss that show.
It's still going.
It's still going, but they don't produce as nearly as much anymore. They recently had a new season come out. I say recently, not that recent.
Yeah. I think I know what the story is.
All right, then. Well, in that case, first I'm going to go with the bonus questions. We'll come on to the story of the week in a little bit. So welcome back. Hope you enjoyed that song break. And what I would like to do is hear your film facts, and hopefully you don't fox me. So who would like to go first?
I can go first, since no one else said anything.
All right, Baqir, you can go first.
Okay, so do you know what the film Armageddon is?
Yes, I do.
Okay, excellent. So you probably do know this fact, but... or you don't, because it's not real. Ooh. basically, for those of you who don't know, it's basically when NASA teaches oil drillers how to be astronauts when they find resources in space. And so Ben Affleck asked director Michael Bay, why would NASA teach oil drillers to be astronauts when they can just teach astronauts how to drill for oil? And Michael Bay told them to shut the F up.
Oh, wow. Yes. Frankly, that needs to be said to Michael Bay a lot more. That guy can go to hell. Very nice, Baqir. I love that. Who'd like to give me their fact next?
I have a fact. It's not a film fact, but because I forgot that it was meant to be a film fact. So it's just.
Pay attention when the teacher's talking, John.
During the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Sorry, it's just so far from a film fact.
If you want, John, you could make up a film fact really quickly right now. I know it was made up, but no, yeah, as you were going to say.
Okay, when they were filming the Cuban Missile Crisis, John Kennedy, the president, had to stay awake for several hours at a time. He lost so much sleep because he was having to do so much diplomacy. And spending so much time in meeting, etc., etc., and so he drank copious amounts of Coca-Cola to keep him awake, as it is a sugary drink with lots of caffeine in it. He Donald Trump was not the first U.S. president to be a massive fan of that sugary drink. So yes.
I see. Cool.
That fact is totally made up.
And finally, Kamran.
So mine's about a film called The 81st Man. Okay. It's a story about the Liechtenstein army during the Austro-Prussian War. They went to battle with 80 men and they came back with 81.
Ooh.
There was a man on the battlefield selling bread and cheese that they just brought back with them.
Okay.
And the film story about that is this film was only ever released in Liechtenstein and never actually released outside that country.
Okay. I can't believe that. The question is, though, how did you see it?
I went to Liechtenstein when I was a kid.
Ah, I see. Okay. So we have an interesting range of facts there. They're all very interesting. Thank you very much. However, I am disqualifying John off the bat simply because it's not a film fact.
Well, if you think about it, Kennedy was a movie star, so it's actor John F. Kennedy during the Cuban Missile Crisis.
Oh dear. I thought for a moment you were going to say he was stayed awake for such a long time because he was busy having sex with Marilyn Monroe.
that too.
God bless her. God bless Marilyn Monroe. Anyway,
there was another missile crisis Kennedy was dealing
with. Oh, God, that doesn't even work. Okay, so yeah, I'm sorry, John, but you're disqualified from this bonus question. Okay, so we have Michael Bay telling Ben Affleck to shut the fuck up.
No, Ben.
Oh, sorry, Michael Bay telling Ben Affleck to shut the fuck up, yeah. And then we have the film only released in Liechtenstein about the weird bloke who decided it was a good idea to sell bread and cheese on a battlefield.
And who returned with the Liechtenstein army.
Hmm.
And Liechtenstein army took zero casualties.
Yes. Now, here is the thing. I know Baqir's fact is true.
Oh.
I know that fact myself. So, I know it is not a fabrication. I do love that fact. And therefore, I am going to give the point to Baqir.
Mine was made up.
Yeah, and I'll be honest, Kamran, you don't need the lead. But
I mean, I could. It's a bonus, you know.
Yeah, but
That's true about the Liechtenstein army, isn't it?
Yeah, I just made up the part about. I also forgot that it was about films, so I just like changed it a bit.
Oh, come on! Well, actually, Baqir, you're the only one who actually answered the question.
You got the point anyway.
Yeah, no.
I just winning by default.
No, but yeah, you did manage to bring it back around to movies, Kamran, and I did like the sound of that. It also sounds like a cool story about the Liechtenstein army. Yeah. But yeah, Baqir, you win the point. Well done. So, finally, the time is here. On this day in history, our song breaks have been Paperback Rider, Red Right Hand, and Rasputin versus Stalin from Epic Rap Battles of History. Who can tell me what happened on this day?
The release date of the Communist Manifesto.
He gets in there like a shot, and he's right. Kamran is right. I will tell you the story. I've got it written down here. On the 21st of February, 1848, which is 173 years ago, the Communist Manifesto was published. It was written by Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels and published in London by a group of German-born revolutionary socialists. It analyzes historical events to prove its points, claiming that most of history is only caused by the oppression of the poor. To quote the book, the history of all hitherto existing society is the history of class struggles. Thanks to the publication of this book, Joseph Stalin would go on to rule a reign of terror over the Russian people, including the Great Purge, which included a large-scale repression of relatively wealthy peasants, ethnic cleansing operations against ethnic minorities, a purge of the Communist Party, of government officials, and of the Red Army leadership. So ultimately, Marx got exactly what he wanted.
Ironic.
Yep.
I don't think... See, the extract that you read from the book, I don't necessarily disagree with, which is the thing.
Yeah, that's the funny thing. And fundamentally, I haven't read it, and I don't really know much about it, but I'm led to understand that on paper, communism doesn't sound so very bad. It's the way it's been used.
Well, you know, I think this is an entirely separate discussion, isn't it?
Yeah.
But I feel like
What's interesting, though, is it wasn't like... Lenin, who was the good communist, it was Trotsky, he was a good communist.
The good communist.
The good.
Wanted to like change things and make it like more democratic and not like an autocracy with the czar. But Lenin was the minority in his own party, but called himself the Bolshevik, which means majority.
Oh, wow. I see.
Interesting.
On an unrelated note, Karl Marx is very high up on my list of greatest historical beards.
Mm. Yes, just right up there with Santa Claus.
Charles Darwin, Charles Dickens, you know, great.
Bin Laden.
Bin Laden.
Say what you want about the man. He had a good beard.
I suppose you're right. Baqir's views do not represent the views of the Lancaster University Comedy Institute in any way, shape, or form.
We are all raving anarchists.
I don't support Bin Laden. I'm just saying he had a big beard. Like,
yeah.
Lancaster University Comedy Institute disagree with my views.
I will not be censured in my own country.
We are politically neutral to Bin Laden.
We're on the fence.
Other terrorists are available.
Yeah, he's like the A-list. He's expensive. Do you know what I mean? You want to start with like someone smaller.
Yeah, and let's quickly move off this before we start saying stuff we'll come to regret. Well done, Kamran.
Thank you. Well done
to everyone, but this draws us to the end of history. I mean, this episode. well done, everybody. I've had great fun. I hope you've had great fun.
It's been really good.
I'm glad to hear you. Glad you've enjoyed yourselves. Thank you. I can, however, announce that the final scores run thusly. In third place, with 6 points, we have Baqir. Oh, hang on a moment. We have... No, you're not in third place. You're tied for second with John.
Yeah.
John and Baqir both have 6 points, which means that in the lead with 9 points, Kamran Khan is our winner this episode.
This reminds me of a really... this reminds me of that time that spy film drew for sixth most highest grossing film in 1959. So, John, we're making history here today.
Yeah, yes. I mean, North by Northwest is a classic movie, so this will be a classic... day for you two. But yeah, well done, Kamran. You are our winner for this week.
Thank you.
Well done. So that everybody brings us to the end of this episode. I hope you've had fun listening. I hope you've learned something. The main takeaway here, as I've said repeatedly, the past was bloody insane. So hop back in your time machines, nip back to the present day. It just remains for me to thank my wonderful contestants. Thank you, Kamran.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, thank you, John.
Thank you for having me.
And thank you, Baqir.
No, Joe. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I've been your host, Joe Dodd. Thank you so much for listening. Goodbye.